This is Paul Poirier at the American Banjo Museum, and we're doing our best to preserve, present, and promote the banjo in all of its styles. But we can't do it without you. We need your support. So I hope you'll join me in contributing to your American Banjo Museum. And thank you.
Everybody, and welcome to the American Banjo Museum and Virtual at Noon. This is our weekly fix of banjo stuff that we know people out there who love the banjo as much as we do enjoy seeing. Thank you for all your comments and the questions you've been sending in and your requests. Today is a request for a virtual rewind show. We had so much fun working with the Kingston Trio in the year 2014. When they were inducted into the American Banjo Museum Hall of Fame, we took it one step further, doing an entire exhibit about the Kingston Trio right here at the museum. It featured the instruments from the original Kingston Trio members and all sorts of memorabilia from their wonderful career that really reinvented folk music back in the 1950s and 60s. So what we're going to do right now is take you back to 2014. We're going to rewind and show you the night the Kingston Trio was inducted into the American Banjo Museum Hall of Fame. It was a memorable evening because the only surviving founding member of the Kingston Trio, Bob Shane, was on hand to be part of the honor. You'll also see the modern day Kingston Trio performing, a great thing because they all three played banjos. That's the first time in anybody's memory that every one of the Kingston Trio was playing a banjo at the same time. And then we're going to take you to the exhibit that we did featuring the Kingston Trio, all their wonderful instruments, memorabilia, gold records, etc. And you will be walked through that exhibit through Kerry Joels' loving eye, who curated the exhibit as part of the Smithsonian Institution. So that's it. If you're a Kingston Trio fan, we know you're in for a treat, and we want to thank you all for visiting the American Banjo Museum virtual at noon every Saturday. Thanks for being here.
In 1958, three charismatic college-age folk singers began an American musical institution known as the Kingston Trio. During their early years, the Kingston Trio was the most popular vocal group in the United States. Through a seemingly endless series of top 10 records, television appearances, and nightclub and concert dates, the Kingston Trio established both a musical entertainment success story, which will never be matched, as well as a nationwide revival in folk music. While the faces may have changed as the group evolved during the past half century, one constant remains in the Kingston Trio's ongoing and positive promotion of the banjo. Although the banjo had been a much-forgotten instrument in pop music culture, when Bob Shane, accompanied by original trio members Dave Gard and Nick Reynolds, plunked the now-familiar introduction to Tom Dooley on his banjo in 1958, the instrument was instantly reborn.
Tom Dooley must hang.
Typifying the spirit and innocence of the times, in their first 10 years, the Kingston Trio released 27 LP albums, amassing recording industry sales milestones which have yet to be matched or broken, including four LPs in Billboard's top five at one time.
A better on the mountain, there I took her life. Better on the mountain.
Thank you.
with hits such as A Worried Man, Tijuana Jail, and The MTA, all anchored by Dave Guard's banjo, the Kingston Trio, and the resurgence and popularity of folk music they created established an unprecedented demand for banjos, causing the ailing Vega Banjo Company to actually add employees just to fill orders. When Dave Guard left the trio in 1961, the banjo identity of the group was assumed by singer-songwriter John Stewart. While such a personnel change might have been akin to replacing one of the Beatles, the public took the change in stride as the second generation of the Kingston Trio continued to deliver old favorites along with new hits such as Greenback Dollar and Where Have All the Flowers Gone?
Where have all the flowers gone, long time ago? Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls pick them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn?
This land. With imitation being the highest form of flattery, the popularity of the Kingston Trio spawned dozens of imitators, while the originals were busy inspiring upcoming folk music legends such as Bob Dylan, Joan Baez, and Peter, Paul, and Mary. As Bob Dylan ignited new social consciousness as he sang The Times They Are A-Changin', the Kingston Trio, just as quickly as they had risen to stardom, found their good-time, apolitical stance no longer relevant nor popular in post-JFK America, and the group disbanded in 1967. Opposed to the breakup, founding member Bob Shane never officially left the band, forming the new Kingston Trio in 1967. With changing partners, including current trio member banjoist Bill Zorn, Bob Shane continued to perform Kingston Trio favorites as well as new material for legions of loyal fans around the country. When Shane acquired the sole rights to the Kingston Trio name in 1976, current banjoist George Grove joined the group and the Kingston Trio was again reborn. An historic 1982 reunion concert, which united the original and current trio members, Bob Shane, Dave Guard, Nick Reynolds, John Stewart, George Grove, and Roger Gamble, provided proof positive of the timeless musical institution which the Kingston Trio had become. After health issues forced Bob Shane to retire from touring in 2004, the institution known as the Kingston Trio goes on, with George Grove, Bill Zorn, and Rick Dougherty continuing to delight audiences as they tour the nation with a banjo along for every step of their musical journey.
And we are indeed delighted, especially to have our founding father, Bob Shane, with us. Thank you very much.
May I say, because not enough is said about Bob Shane, but it's not just the banjo that he kept alive for 47 years working the Kingston Trio. It's folk music in general. He went out and kept playing when nobody else wanted to. So when the others wanted to come back and play, there were places to play because Bob Shane kept it alive. That's his contribution. See you there, guys. Okay.
It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. I'm worried now, but I won't be worried long.
Well, I got myself a brand new house 5 miles out of town. Got myself a brand new banjo, $30 down. Got myself a gal named Sue, treats me really fine. She likes my picking.
and I love her all the time.
It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. I'm worried now, but I won't be worried long.
Now I've been away on a business trip, traveling all around. I got a gal and her name is Sue, prettiest gal in town. Sets my mind to worrying every time I'm gone. I'll be home tonight, so I won't be worried long.
It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. I'm worried now, but I won't be worried long.
But Billy's in the living room holding hands with Sue. George is at the old front door about to come on through. Well, I'm here in the closet. Oh, Lord, what shall I do?
Not bad.
We're worried now.
Got some old banjos in here.
But we won't be worried long. It takes a worried, worried man to sing a worried, worried song. It takes a worried, worried man to sing a worried, worried song. It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. I'm worried now, but I won't be worried long.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Thank you one and all. Thank you, Mr. Bob.
Hi, I'm Dr. Kerry Joels, the curator of the Kingston Trio Legacy Project, and our exhibit, traveling exhibit, is A World of Music. Kingston Trio formed in California in late 1950s. The trio was actually a recipient of the great legacy of a lot of musical forms and traditions. Two of the trio members were from Hawaii, and one of them, Dave Gard, studied the Hawaiian slack guitar by Gabby Pahanui. He also studied Pete Seeger's five-string banjo book, and basically there were three young guys who learned how to play a few chords, got together, and under the tutelage of their manager, Frank Werber, turned themselves into the powerhouse group of the late 50s, early 60s in the folk music explosion. Their first song, Tom Dooley, sold 3 million albums, 3 million copies rather, and their first album went over 1 million copies, the Kingston Trio. The first song, Tom Dooley, was actually about a Southern Confederate soldier in a true story, a true murder trial, where as a triangle, his sweetheart during the war married and he came back and started dating her cousin, and they think in a fit of rage, maybe the sweetheart killed her, but Tom took the rap. And after three murder trials covered as far away as New York City, Dooley was hanged. North Carolina folk song was written about him and was sung in the North Carolina hills from 1868 to the present. Another one of their famous songs was the MTA, about a man named Charlie who got stuck on the MTA because they changed the rules. You had to pay an extra nickel to get off. Charlie couldn't get off. This is actually a 1955 MTA map that we put in the exhibit, which has the lyrics showing all the places that Charlie talks about, visits, and gets his sandwich handed to him in the Scully Square station. This is one of the Kingston Trio's gold records. They were, at the time, as big a group for their time as the Beatles were, and along the bottom here we have a timeline which includes all of the Kingston Trio albums and important single releases, and also the firsts and things that were happening during those years. So you can get a sense from 1957 to 67 what was going on during the history of the original trio. The trio went through several stages. In 1961, Dave Gard and Nick Reynolds and Bob Shane were the number one group in the world. And Bob and Nick loved the performance aspect. Dave was pretty cerebral, and he wanted to expand in new directions, and so he left the group. And leaving the group left them with a huge hole. They had to fill it. There was a young musician who had written some songs for the trio, was a member of then the Cumberland Three, named John Stewart. John stepped in, and it was almost a seamless transition. John was young, he was 21 years old, great banjo player, great writer. He wound up writing a lot of the trio songs. He was politically active. President Kennedy asked him to write a song called The New Frontier, which resulted in the trio's New Frontier album. One of the things we have here is the fact that John was very close to Kennedy, and Kennedy gave him one of his little mementos, which was him in his Kennedy rocker, all the more poignant because this is the 50th anniversary this month of Kennedy's assassination. Another thing we put in the exhibit was some of the roots of the trio, which included Woody Guthrie and Doc Watson, the Weavers with Pete Seeger and Gabby. And after the trio, the explosion, literal explosion of folk music. I'll talk more about that later. But the Chad Mitchell Trio, Brothers Four, Limelighters, Highwaymen, Joan Baez, Journeyman, Judy Collins, Smothers Brothers, Peter, Paul, and Mary, New Christy Minstrels, and even rock groups were influenced. Al Jardine of the Beach Boys went with his cousins, Brian Wilson, the Wilsons, and Mike Love, formed the Beach Boys. And if you'll notice on the early Beach Boys record, they wore the striped shirts made famous by the Kingston Trio. They thought of that branding was so powerful that they wanted that image of clean cut and professionalism. So you have all of these different things, even down to the Eagles and folk rockers, all, again, derived their impetus from the Kingston Trio. Their legacy after 1967 was very important. They did form one of the trendy restaurants in the Bay Area, but Dave Gard had formed the Whiskey Hill Singers. Nick and John worked with some of the Fleetwood Mac people. John wrote Daydream Believer for the Monkees and did a very collaborative work with Lindsey Buckingham. They had a reunion concert in 1981, very famous concert. And most of today's folk stars, if you talk to them, will acknowledge their roots in the Kingston Trio. In the exhibit, we have a lot of different quotes from people in the music industry. We're doing an oral history project and interviewing these people, and it'll go eventually into the National Archives, Folk Archives. We have about 22 people interviewed, and they're all here, Pete Seeger, Bill Mumy, the actor, Timothy B. Schmidt of the Eagles, all affected in one way or another, either professionally or personally, by knowing the trio. Who were the trio? The first trio was Dave Gard, who was from Hawaii. He and Bob Shane met at the Punahou School, which has had a lot of very important alumni like Barack Obama. It's a private school. And Dave played the Vega banjo. This is his original Vega banjo and is part of the collection here, the permanent collection here at the American Banjo Museum. Very important piece. Bob Shane was the showman. He, after meeting Nick and Dave and singing with them, went back to Hawaii to join his father's business. Fortunately, he didn't stay in that business. He was also entertaining at night. He was, for a while, known as the Elvis of Hawaii because he would do popular music, and he got called back when they said, hey, Bob, we need you. It's not working out with anybody else. Bob came back, and that was the story. And this is a Martin D28 guitar, 1958 Martin, 51 Martin D28, which was the first guitar that Bob had, and this guitar gave the trio that large sound. It's a very deep, beautiful instrument. Nick Reynolds was from Coronado, California. I really enjoy some of the history of Nick. When he was a little kid, he went down to Tijuana, was in the Tijuana jail. Who knew that someday it would be a mega hit for them? Nick was a very active guy. He was a fisherman, a tennis player, sports car driver. He was the short one, and his guitar was a Martin Tenor, the 018T Tenor guitar. And this is one of Nick's guitars, which he played at this very rapid pace. If you could ever see, go to YouTube, pull up the Kingston Trio, and watch Nick. So you have this very loud, melodic, rich sound from the D28. You've got this impact from the tenor, and you've got that banjo coming cleanly through, and the three harmonizing voices, which made the trio very distinctive. When Dave left, John Stewart stepped in, and as I mentioned, John had a lot of relationships with the Kennedy family. John, after Bobby was killed, actually helped raise some of the Kennedys, and we've talked to them, and it was a very emotional thing. John marched in Selma, Alabama. The trio, by and large, was not political, and they were criticized somewhat for it, and yet, John was very involved. They were involved. They went to the White House and for a command performance and picked Where Have All the Flowers Gone, which is a very one of the anthems of the anti-war movement. So they were not afraid to do that. And this is a Vega banjo of the type that John played. Frank Werber was the manager of the trio, and Frank was the prototype of the modern entertainment manager. Brian Epstein of the Beatles and everybody else really were emulators of Frank Werber. He packaged them, he arranged them, he got them coaching, training. They scripted all of their spontaneous chatter between songs. So everything was incredibly professional. He worked them very hard, but the trio responded. They did over 200 concerts a year for 10 years and produced almost 3 albums a year in the studio, which is a brutal, brutal schedule. We do have in the exhibit a couple of little gourmet things. One of them is one of Nick Reynolds' original ukuleles. Nick came from a Navy family in Coronado, California. It's a famous naval air station. And his family used to sit around, play the ukulele, and sing. So Nick grew up with music, as did Bob and Dave and John. And this is Nick's original bongos, which he played with Bob Shane when they first met at Menlo Business College. And the two of them got together, and they pulled Dave, who was at Stanford, across the, up the road, into forming the original trio. One of the more interesting things for me researching this was not only the magnitude of the trio's impact, but the fact that they really changed the music industry. The trio did some of the original overdubbing, some of the original experimental production work. They literally institutionalized the long playing record. At the time, the 45 with the big hole was what they put out singles on. The trio would do groups of songs so that an album was an experience. You could play it and enjoy it. The other thing they did was they kicked off the folk revolution in terms of people buying guitars. Tom Dooley was called the song that sold 10,000 guitars because everybody was buying a guitar, everybody was singing folk music on college campuses, around campfires. It was a huge thing, and companies like the Martin Company and the Vega Company, now owned by Deering, literally exploded in sales and were building extra factories and to meet that need. They literally got America singing. The other record companies were trying desperately to cash in on the trio's incredible success, and there are literally dozens of albums put out by record companies trying to find a trio to equal. And I love some of these, like the Princeton Trio and the Dauphin Trio, the Deauville Trio, 3 from Montana. They were all trios, and they were trying to capture that magic. And there are, again, literally dozens of them. These are some of the hand-picked favorites. But you can see they're all trios, usually banjo and 2 guitars or 3 guitars. And again, tried to emulate them, and unfortunately, you probably never heard of any of these. But you have heard of the legacy folk artists like Bob Dylan and Joan Baez and Peter, Paul, and Mary, who literally made the folk music a household phenomenon. Kingston Trio Legacy Project put this together in Coronado, California, at the Coronado Historical Society, and we've been traveling it. It was there a year. It'll be here at the American Banjo Museum for a year, and then scheduled to go back to California at another venue at this point. We're very pleased with this because we're accompanying it with a new education program that will provide educational materials and musical materials for music educators. We want people singing again. We want people doing folk music again. And so our oral history and our education will go well beyond the exhibit, but we're very proud to have it here at the American Banjo Museum.
Well, there you have it. We hope you've enjoyed visiting with the Kingston Trio and seeing this wonderful group in action. It was a memorable experience for me to spend some time with Bob Shane and all the guys. And if you're a guy like me, no banjo player can say that they weren't influenced by the Kingston Trio's music. Everybody loves the tunes and the way the banjo made them sound. So on behalf of all banjo players, thank you to the Kingston Trio, thank you Bob Shane, and for you, thank you for tuning in. Join us next Saturday for American Banjo Museum Virtual at Noon. Till then, bye-bye.